Thank you all for joining us for a panel titled Up to the Minute, Iran, Changing Perspectives. For hosting us today, I want to thank the Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs, the Sharmin and Bijan Mossavar-Rahmani Center for Iran and Persian Gulf Studies, and the Department and Program in Near Eastern Studies at Princeton University. I also want to extend my gratitude to Dr. Luciano Zaccara for initiating the idea for this panel. With us today to discuss Iran, to my left is Dr. Nura Hossainzadeh, lecturer in Near Eastern Studies at Princeton, specializing in modern Iran and contemporary Iranian political thought. Dr. Luciano Zaccara, a current visiting scholar at Princeton Center for Iran and Persian Gulf Studies and research assistant professor in Gulf politics at the Qatar University Gulf Studies Center. To my right, Dr. Djavad Salehi-Isfahani, professor of economics at Virginia Tech, a non-resident senior fellow at the Brookings Institution and visiting research scholar at the Mossavar-Rahmani Center at Princeton. And Dr. Amin Moghadam, geographer and associate research scholar at the Mossavar-Rahmani Center and Paris and at the Paris Diderot University. I am Banafshe Kenush. I work on Iran and its foreign policy, and I'm your moderator for today's program. This panel will offer the opportunity to discuss the recent unrest in Iran. But we will not focus on the protests because a lot of work has been produced about it. And humbly, we admit that we do not have a crystal ball to see into the future. For the sake of brevity, we will rather focus on a number of thematic issues relevant to understanding Iran. The recent unrest brought to the forefront a number of interlocking facts. Protests have become a daily reality in Iran, and the state is catching up. But it's also trying to establish a dialogue with society. Interfactional rivalries in Iran seem to embolden society by opening space for venting out frustrations. Reform in Iran has political boundaries that are being stretched. Iran's foreign policy may or may not be impacted by the internal changes in the country, depending on Iran's regional and international threat perceptions at any given point of time. Due to real or potential threats, safety and security remain a major consideration for average Iranians. There is no major or detectable synchronicity between changes inside Iran and voices outside Iran, though the two at times may influence each other. In order to better understand these issues, I now want to turn the floor to our panelists, and we will start from left to right. After the panel discussions, we'll open the floor for questions and answers. As you can see, there are two microphones on both sides here, so we invite you to please take the opportunity to raise your questions. As is the format with the Woodrow Wilson Center, we will take questions from students first. So with these words, I now turn to the panel. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Banafshe, and thank you all of you for coming today. And thank you to the Iran Center and the Woodrow Wilson School of Near Eastern Studies for sponsoring this event and my fellow panelists for being here today. So today I'm just going to speak about how many of the political debates in contemporary Iran originate in disagreements about the nature or character of an Islamic republic, debates that go back to the early days just after the revolution. I'm going to speak about how these disagreements have led to debate in contemporary Iran about the way that governmental institutions function. And for the sake of time, I'm going to focus on three institutions: the position of the Guardian, the Assembly of Experts, and the Guardian Council. So in recent protests in January, we heard many of the protesters say, "Magbad dictator," death to the dictator, referring, of course, to Ali Khamenei, the Guardian jurisprudent, or Vali Faqih. He is a powerful figure, both because of his constitutional powers and because he has come to exercise powers not explicitly given to him by the Constitution, but perhaps still sanctioned by the constitutional text. The current Constitution, which is the product of a revision in 1989, unlike the original 1979 Constitution, gives him two vaguely stated powers: one, to determine the overall politics of the Islamic Republic, and two, to supervise the proper implementation of the general policies of the system. So these clauses are often invoked to justify his exercise of a broad range of powers, but constitutionally, some of his most important powers include appointing the jurisprudence to the Guardian Council, which oversees parliament, appointing the head of the judiciary, and commanding the military and Sepah. But as guardian, he's also come to exercise, as I said, additional powers, perhaps justified by those two vaguely stated clauses, and such as including issuing hukum hokumati, so governmental ordinances, which go over and above parliamentary law, and also controlling or limiting the country's foreign policy aims. Many who support the Guardian's expansive powers invoke a statement that Khomeini made in 1988, in which he says that government exercises a guardianship, quote, that was given by God to the Prophet and is the most important of God's laws and has priority over all the laws of the Sharia. In other words, he was saying that the interests and aims of government take priority over ordinances derived from the Sharia. But it's important to note here that the laws passed by government must still conform to the principles of the Sharia, so in that way they didn't violate the Sharia, including centrally the principle of securing the well-being of the nation. So out of this statement, conservatives have interpreted the doctrine of the absolute guardianship of the jurisprudent, or velayat-e mutlaqeh-e faqih, that the jurisprudent himself has the power to act over and above the law, whether it's the Sharia law or the constitutional law, meaning explicitly stated ordinances of the Sharia law or the constitutional law. Whereas reformists often point out that Khomeini didn't give this authority explicitly to the guardian, but instead to government as a whole, acting through the proper legislative and executive organs, which includes a popularly elected parliament and president. Hossein Ali Montazeri is one thinker and activist who argued that the powers of the guardian need to be circumscribed. As you may know, Khomeini had originally chosen Montazeri to be his successor before later on Khomeini changed his mind. In Montazeri's essay, Democracy and Constitution, he's critical of this concept of the absolute guardianship of the jurisprudent. And as a prominent ideologue of the reformist movement, he passed away just several months after the contested 2009 elections. Montazeri, like other reformists, have called for the Assembly of Experts to take on a more active role in government. So what is the Assembly of Experts? The Assembly of Experts is a democratically elected body that oversees the guardian and has the power to dismiss him and elect a new guardian. So it's a democratically elected body. There's evidence that Khomeini himself, in the years following the revolution, envisioned the Assembly to have an active role and to criticize the guardian openly. He encouraged people to vote in elections for the Assembly, and on November 7th, 1979 in a speech says that people should feel free to criticize the Guardian. He says that the Guardian's ethics, his belief in religion, his devotion to the nation, his knowledge and his actions, all these must be acceptable to the nation, he says. But in practice, the Assembly has never challenged or criticized the Guardian, although individual members have expressed their concerns about the country's direction. So never criticized it, at least openly. Criticized him at least openly. And then in addition to focusing on the constraining role that may be played by the Assembly of Experts in constraining the Guardian, reformists also criticize the fact that the Guardian Council vets and disqualifies candidates for the Assembly of Experts, for the Parliament, and for the presidency. The Constitution, though, what's interesting is the Constitution doesn't give it the power to vet candidates for the Assembly of Experts and for Parliament. It simply says that the Guardian Council supervises these elections. And reformists have argued that it exercises this power illegitimately. Montazeri was the president of the first Assembly of Experts, which drafted the 1979 Constitution. And he said in an interview in 1999 and also in 2000 that the original drafters did not intend the clause which gives the Guardian Council a supervisory role over elections, didn't intend that clause to mean that it would vet, that it would have the ability to disqualify candidates. And that language was carried on until the 1989 Constitution. So debates in contemporary Iran over the prerogatives of democratic and non-democratic institutions in government are not new. As I've described, they originate in the early days of the revolution when prominent figures and parties disagreed about the extent to which Islamic government would respect and promote democratic principles. Questions persist today about the power of Islamic clerics in government. They're far from resolved, and only time will tell how Iranians ultimately decide to answer these questions. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you very much to all of you for joining us. Following up what my colleague said here, I will be showing three slides to show you the electoral trends that were visible in the last couple of years in Iran in order to analyze what is happening in terms of electoral support to the current government or even to the system, as some people might be asking about that. So the first slide, what is showing is the result of the last legislative elections that they were held in February 2016, so a couple of years ago, in which is visible the victory of the list of hope, which is mainly composed by reformist candidates, even though we can make some comments about that in the Q&A session. What this result show, I mean, the new composition of the parliament, we will be active until 2020, shows is that this has been a victory of the candidates and groups that support the current president, Hassan Rouhani, who was elected for the first time in 2013. And this meant that it was visible in the further evolution of the parliament decisions taken about governmental initiatives, like, for instance, the approval of the or the explicit support given to the nuclear deal JCPOA signed by the government later on. Also, this composition of this new parliament 2016 shows that there was a victory of the centrist groups of the assembly on the detriment of more radical groups, like some of them supporting the previous president Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, who really created a lot of problems in terms of foreign policy for Iran. This new parliament was later on favorable to the new cabinet proposed by Rouhani when he renewed his term in May 2017 election. You know that, there's a lot of check and balances within the Iranian political system in which the parliament needs to approve, it is requested the parliamentary approval for all the candidates for ministerial positions. So it is essential for the government to count with the parliament support. With this parliament, Rouhani had no problem in passing all this new cabinet. The second slide is showing the result of the presidential elections 2017 compared with the 2013, for you to see which were the difference in the numbers of the two elections. What is important to point out here is that the victory of Hassan Rouhani on 19th May elections was very clear and conclusive, confirming the pre-electoral predictions that they were published beforehand. He obtained more than 5 million more votes that he obtained compared with 2013. Of course, you have to bear in mind that there are more people voting in the second election, but most of these new voters, if we make a comparison, decided to support Hassan Rouhani. So the support for presidential policies were evident. At the same time that these elections took place, they were held elections at municipal level, which is not very well known when we discuss about Iranian politics. The most important capital cities, provincial capital cities like Tehran, Mashhad, Isfahan, and Shiraz, were recovered by reformists, were cities that, to some extent, they were controlled by the conservative candidates. In the last election, in most of these these cities, the whole composition of the municipal council belongs to the reformists, and therefore most of the city mayors were from a reformist background. Then we can discuss whether reformists mean in the political discourse in Iran. But to make it clear in this case, or to make it simple in this case, reformists or pragmatist groups are those who are really supporting Rouhani's policies right now. The Iranian political system is composed of complex networks, network of elected and non-elected institutions that control each other along the decision-making process, as I try to show here. In this context, the important function of the elections electoral process is, even within the authoritarian limits set by the Iranian constitution, can be summarized as follows. First, elections highlight intra-elite disputes, so all these differences between conservative, reformist, pragmatists are decided within the electoral framework. Second, the elections allow the government to periodically check on the people's orientation, so voters can give opinion at least every certain period of time about political, the government orientation or the policies implemented by the state by choosing one candidate against the other. And the third the third function of the election is that they bring elected candidates into office. So those who win elections in Iran at presidential, municipal, and legislative level, they get into office and they perform into their positions. Despite all the shortcomings present in the Iranian electoral system, it cannot be denied that there is some degree of competition and that the elections do have an impact on the political system and therefore in the policies implemented by the government and laws passed by the parliament. This is very visible if we compare, for instance, how was the tenure of President Mohammad Khatami before Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, and if we compare Mahmoud Ahmadinejad's tenure with current President Rouhani. In this specific context, 2016-2017, Iranian people clearly showed their support to the current administration, meaning Hassan Rouhani government, despite the lack of visible achievement at the economic level. So this is basically what I wanted to say about how we can understand the electoral system and how can we understand the support provided by the Iranian people, at least in the two last electoral processes that they took place in 2016 and 2017. Thank you very much.
Should I go?
Please.
Thank you. I want to address two questions that arise out of the protests that you all know about that occurred in Iran 6 or 7 weeks ago. The first question is, do these protests indicate that a larger uprising is in the works? Does it have the potential to reach that? And can it threaten the regime? And this is the question that has been asked in the digital sphere, which went buzzing. It goes buzzing every time there are protests in Iran. Not so when you have protests in like Mexico or Tunisia and so on, but because there's an interest in, at least in Washington, D.C., to see a weaker Iranian state, that the hopes are raised when there are protests. And I'll try to answer that question briefly. And the second question that I'm interested in is more my area, is do they indicate that there are dire economic situations in Iran that causes these kind of protests? And this question is particularly interesting because if there is a dire economic condition in Iran, it means that the nuclear deal, so-called JCPOA, has failed. And if it has failed, then Iran has an interest to pull out of it and do something else. And today, the deputy foreign minister came with very strong words, saying that we are not benefiting from JCPOA, therefore we might not want to continue. I rather doubt that they will pull out anytime soon, but anyway, that question of what does it mean about Iran's economic condition is very important. So about the first question, it is about the future, and it's about something I don't know about. We don't have the crystal ball, as Banafsheh said. But let me at least list a few reasons why it may not have the kind of potential that people ascribe to it. First thing is that protests, again, as Banafsheh said, are normal in Iran. There are people who gather almost every day in one city or another to protest in front of a bank or a financial institution that is not giving back their money. And security forces don't break those things up. They watch it, and it often ends peacefully. Workers march often because of back pay. Their wages are not paid. System of banking in Iran is not working very well at the other side, so that producers, companies, get short of cash. First thing they do is not pay the wages on time, so people start, again, walking to the ministry or this or that, and again, those things usually end peacefully. So the other thing to notice about the protests is that people may not know, but there were people have done careful work on this, looked at data. They identified about 73 cities that were in which protests took place. And Iran has over 400 cities. So fewer than one out of five cities ignited in that sense. So it's not really like a huge national thing that was occurring across the country. So let me now turn to the second question. And the second question is, are the economic conditions really bad? And I want to say, yes, they are bad. But then they are bad in most of the countries in the region, and they are not very unusual. The only unusual item is the bank failures and the banking crisis. And the reason why Iran has a banking crisis is that its banks grow when there is oil money. Price of oil goes up and down. There have been two periods in which the price has risen for about 10 years, and it's been high, giving rise to expectations that this can't continue for a long time. The first time it occurred was in the 1970s. And there would have certainly been a bank failure, serious bank failure, had there not been a revolution that postponed that question, that just muted the whole thing. People had borrowed a lot, invested in real estate. Real estate prices are highly correlated with the oil price. When the oil price collapsed in 1982 through 84, real estate would have collapsed. Banks would have lost their assets, would not have been able to pay their money back. Lucky for those who were running that system, the revolution happened in a way, and that issue never became known. It's too bad that people did not look very carefully in Iran at this issue and find out what's the source of it. They thought, well, the Shah was running the country, he's bad, he's gone, no more problems. Ahmadinejad comes to power, there's another oil price increase and another real estate boom, and again, the banks are not doing well at all. I mean, not all the banks, but some of the these banks that were paying higher interest rates, and they become Ponzi schemes. Any bank that goes down starts paying high deposit rates to attract deposits, to pay back the previous depositors, and things don't go well after that. But there's a lot of exaggeration other than this about economic conditions. New York Times had an op-ed in which it was claimed that 40% of Iranians are living under poverty. If you Google that, many, many other articles come with the same result. That's not true. We did a study with the World Bank. It was very carefully reviewed on a poverty rate with a $5.50 poverty line was 9.5%, and it's about that. A little bit gone up, but it's not the kind of increase that would cause mass riots. New York Times, again, wrote, they should have known better because they have a person in Tehran, lives in Tehran, that youth unemployment is 40%. That is not true. It is 20, 25%. 40% is Algeria's unemployment rate, where you don't see protests. So there is this tendency to exaggerate because there's the negative news on Iran, because you get a lot of hits on your website if you do that, because a lot of people are asking themselves the same question. Is this regime going to fall? Is this riots, is JCPOA going to fail? And things like that. There are stagnant incomes in urban areas, smaller urban areas, and rural areas. The reason is the oil money that comes, and JCPOA is like oil money, about $50 billion that arrived in Iran after JCPOA. That money starts trickling from Tehran all the way down. It takes a couple of years to get to smaller cities, to rural areas, and it hasn't gotten there yet. People know the money has come. People see that Tehran is doing better. Tehran is the only place where real incomes, household incomes, went up in the last 2 years. Everywhere else, it was either stagnant or was going down. Then finally, Rouhani's budget was a very unfortunate one. Had it occurred in any other country, there would have been riots. They announced they were going to raise gasoline prices by 50%, at the same time cut down on the cash transfers they were giving people in lieu of higher energy prices. You know, again, I mentioned Mexico. They had an increase of 20% in energy prices, and the country nearly erupted. So what are the good things that have happened? And I want to hear say something positive about the nuclear deal. Inflation is down. It was very costly to bring it down from high of 35% to 10%, but it has come down. People paid a high price. Unemployment was high, and real incomes fell. But it's down, and that sets the stage for macroeconomic rebound. JCPOA, or the nuclear deal, came just in time. In 2016-17, the Iranian fiscal year, the economy grew by 11%. That was the highest growth rate that year anywhere in the world. Why? Because it was at a very low ebb, so it bounced back. This year is growing at about 5 or 6%. And it's all because Iran is able to do trade, is able to sell oil and buy stuff, is able to use the banking system not the way it wants, but in a limited way. FDI has stalled, unfortunately. That's foreign direct investment, because of all the noise made in Washington about this JCPOA is falling apart. Don't do anything. Wait, wait, wait. So people are waiting, and that is costing Iran a lot. The thing about JCPOA is to think about what social scientists call counterfactual. What would have been Iran like had there not been a nuclear deal? The gap in incomes easily would have been 20%. So the 11% that is went up, and another 5%, and had it not been able to export oil, economy would have gone down. And I think a lot of Iranians are aware of that. That's why they like the nuclear deal. That's why they support Rouhani to a large extent. They realize what it would have been like had they continued on the same path and what it is like today. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So for my presentation, I'm going to change the scale, I would say, and as a geographer, I would go to a lower level and trying to look at some local or localized issues. I don't know if you can see the borders on the map because of the light. I think borders are a little bit invisible. But so my contribution as a geographer will be to the exploration of two socio-spatial phenomena. The first one is to look at the geography of borderlands and borders. And the second one is the geography, I would say again, of shopping malls and how we can link that to the issue of urban spatial injustice. So because we talk a lot about inequalities. Of course, it's a little bit harder to link and relate micro-level analysis to these bigger events, but and I'm not here trying to find a causality relationship between what I will be talking about and the recent unrest, but I think that you know recent development give us also the opportunity to think and reflect on various dynamics that characterize Iran and it's the goal of the panel, I assume. So we are obviously lacking information and in-depth ethnographic works on the sites of the recent demonstration, but we know more or less that there were local factors on each site where the demonstration took place. Now taking into consideration the specificities of each site is important because very often the awareness of change starts at the local level, not at the larger level. We can also think of a domino effect that resulted from the possibility of linking these, you know, different local causes together. Unfortunately, Narges Bajorli couldn't be here, but I think the role of social media network was very important in relating these local issues and creating this domino effect. The two examples I'm giving, of course, there are many localized examples. It's because it's part of my ethnographic work. Otherwise, I'm sure that there are many other examples that we can use. The first one is the management of the borders between Iran and Iraqi Kurdistan that has always been irregular and controlled on a very discretionary basis by constantly opening and closing them. And these decisions are justified very often of opening and closing based on security concern, national interest, foreign policy, and that happened again during the protests. So following the referendum that I'm sure you heard about in Kurdistan on 25th of September, the borders were totally closed, and there were rumors every day that one point was open and the other one was closed, and this situation was very much disputed by both local authorities and provinces, but also local population, and you know those whose everyday life basically depends on the back and forth movement between the two national territories. So the impact, consequences of the closure of these borders was huge on the everyday life of transborder population. These areas of, so the three points and the cities, Piranshah is a city where I conducted ethnographic work, where the everyday life more than, according to the Iranian PM, more than 4,000 merchants' life depend on these back and forth movements, and also other, you know, businessmen from other areas of Iran. So this cities, as I said, they are very dependent on this back and forth. And the rate of unemployment, as Dr. Salehi just mentioned, is higher in general in peripheral areas. And Kurdistan is actually the second province in Iran in terms of unemployment. So protests are Protests started on December 28 in Mashhad and the western part of Iran, close to the border, was one of the main sites of the protests starting on December 29 and 30th. In addition to that, an earthquake occurred in Kermanshah, not far from the same region, and the mismanagement of the situation was very much underlined by, you know, experts and observers. So eventually the border was officially reopened on January 2nd, so in the middle of the period of protests, so probably it's not an accident, and huge economic losses were reported at the local level. So we see here how centralized policies, security concerns related to the Iranian foreign policy could have unexpected repercussions at the local level and lead to the general discontent. Now we are talking about discontent, and discontent is a kind of subjective state of mind. So it's hard to, you know, relate directly and say this is exactly why people they went on the street. I think we can't see very well the map. Example that I would like to underline here, without going necessarily into the details, is the multiplication of shopping malls in Iran. These shopping malls are the result of neoliberal urban policies that were in place, that were used since the end of 90s, and, you know, speculative activities that are aiming basically at maximization of the land value and the transformation of these malls into financial assets without having necessarily any socioeconomic justifications. Just to give you an example, this map was made recently by a French student who went to Iran and did fieldwork for 6 months, and he reported that in 2017 we had 200 to 400 shopping centers in Tehran based on the criteria that one would use to define its centers, but some of them, as you can see, the squares, the red ones are the mega malls, so the new ones that are, you know, the most trendy malls. Now, how could we relate that to the issue of the current unrest? You know, the generalization of these shopping centers in an economic situation very well described by Professor Salehi, you know, leads also to new forms of what geographers call spatial injustice, and urban, you know, scale in a way is feeding social frustrations because they don't necessarily have the bright purchasing power to go and benefit from these places. And at the same time, these spaces, they became, you know, spaces of the everyday life. For some of them are new public spaces of Iranians, but they are not necessarily able to use them, and they are facing, you know, in a way, they reflect and reveal the social inequalities in the everyday life. So I'm just insisting on the fact that how and why it's important to consider the everyday life as a factor, and understanding the everyday life as a way of understanding bigger issues. So in this context of, I'm finishing here, of, I would say, survival economy, but also speculative economy for many Iranians, I assume the resistance to liberalization reforms and austerity is almost predictable, you know, consequences. Thank you very much.
What a great panel. And I think that the diversity of thematic issues presented here makes it, in my humble opinion, a very unique contribution to this field of study. The panel regrets that one of our panelists, Dr. Nargis Bajoglu, was unable to come here because she also has very unique perspectives about the synchronicity of reforms within Iran and outside, and she's done incredible field work in Iran as well, and produced work that is, I believe, unsurpassed in many areas. Having said that, I want to congratulate our panelists. We have actually saved time for more questions and answers. So I'd like to invite our students first to please take the opportunity to grab these mics and tell us what you think, if you have any questions, as well as the Princeton community and the community here at large. I will, with your permission, take a few questions at a time and kind of paraphrase them and then turn to the panel. Would you like to use the mic, sir? Yes, please.
Can you? I'm just trying to understand the issue of Israel and Iran as Israel the adversary, and vice versa. I'm just looking at numbers here, is that Israel's percentage of the GDP for military is about 3.5 times larger than Iran. And similarly, the GDP in Iran per capita is also 3 times smaller than Israel, okay? That's an important, so from a military perspective, there's a big lag in expenditures, okay, in Israel. It's about 3.5 times larger in Israel. Now the question is the reason for Iran looking at Israel as an adversary, is it related to the military strategic issue, dominance, military dominance in the Middle East, and also maybe interfering or being between the relations of the United States and Iran as being somewhere between? Or is it something to do with the Palestinian issue, religious? I'm not sure which way it is. Is it strategic? Okay, looking at the expenditures also on military, and Israel becoming a military power, or is it something, and also obviously the relation with the United States, you know, interfering, being between, which could present some problems. Or is it something of a more religious, cultural Palestinian issue?
Thank you very much. I'd like to take one or two more questions. Do we have any questions? Could you please use the microphone? I again invite everyone to use the microphones because then we'll be able to record the Q&A as well.
Hi. First, thank you for the great panel. So I had a question for Dr. Isfahani about Iran's the current devaluation of the Iranian currency vis-a-vis the dollar, and what are some of the factors behind it, and to what extent can the government control it and kind of bring the rial back? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, we seem to have received two questions, on one on foreign policy and one on economic policies. I'll defer the economic issue to Dr. Isfahani, to Djavad first, but if I may, I will just rephrase the question about Israel, because it seems, based on the great figures that you provided, that there is a disproportionality between how much Israel may spend for military purposes versus Iran, and given the fact, as you mentioned correctly, perhaps that Iran's GDP is less, well, then Iran is at a disadvantage, even if it wanted to spend more militarily. It may not be able to. But then, being that the case, why are they at each other's throats? Because militarily it doesn't make sense for them to clash, perhaps. Is it cultural? Is it religious? Is it about Palestine? Is it strategic? What is it? I turn this question to the panel at large. And about the economic question, we have been receiving news, as you know, Djavad, about the pegging of the dollar. And one of the purposes of it has been to release some funds from Iran's National Development Fund, if I am correct. Can you tell us why those funds are needed and how critical is the dollar debate to Iran's economic sanity? So let's start with the foreign policy question first. Anyone?
Thank you. Thank you. Well, I mean, if I can say something about that specific issue, I would say that it's more ideological rather than strategic or military issue. I mean, this is a one of the issues that the Khomeini said at the beginning of the Islamic Revolution, I mean, the main pillars of the Islamic Revolution ideology in the 70s was to fight against imperialism and to fight against Zionism in the Middle East. So the way in which they perceive Israel is as a colonialist, imperialist imposition in the Middle East. And it's it's a right for all the Muslims to defend the rights of the Palestinians against the Zionism as political entity. So I would say that it's much more ideological than anything else. Then it became strategic as well, because the way in which alliances are made in the region, who is against who, Israel is always present in all the combinations, because it's a very important actor in the region. Whether Iran would do or something specific at the military level, I would doubt about that. I mean, as you say, I mean, there is no comparison between the expenditure between Iran and Israel about military build-up, and I don't think it would be ever a confrontation between both states.
Could I just add one other question here, if I may? In your opinion, to what extent is the clash, or the lack of a direct clash, for that matter, between Israel and Iran dependent on their views of the Arab world? After all, both feel encircled by developments in the Arab world, and both are, with Turkey, the only three non-Arab states of the Middle East region. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, as you say, I mean, the three, Turkey, Iran, and Israel, are the three non-Arab states in the region, but they are maybe the most influential in regional politics. Nowadays, there's no other state rather than these three in making decisions at the regional level about Syria, about Iraq, about other issues, even regardless or despite the fact that the Saudis are not very happy with this, and Egypt and other powers are not happy. I would say that in the regional politics, the Arab countries, they lost their capability or the capacity to influence in regional politics. And this might be also another element to add to this combination about who is confronting to who in order to determine the rules of the game in the region. And of course, you have Iran and Israel in both, in absolutely opposite sides in this, even though they both, as you said, they are surrounded or they feel surrounded by Arab or non very friendly states.
Just to be a little mischievous, so should Israel and Iran be concerned by Arabs at all, or not really in the developments in the Arab world?
I mean, as a whole, I mean, I don't think it's a reason to concern about, generally speaking, about the Arabs, but of course, it depends on how regional politics is evolving, how different governments are reacting, how different non-state groups are reacting. I mean, we have a new, a different political arena now in which non-state actors are becoming very influential in policy making. So it's very difficult to put all together in the same box.
Thank you. So with all that uncertainty in Iran's surrounding neighborhoods, Javad, how is Iran going to manage this economic issue, the vital issue of the dollar? The dollar to us is like gold. I remember when I first started working in Iran, my mother's first advice was, convert it into dollars. It'll be more stable. And I took her advice. I don't know if it was the right advice or the wrong one. So please tell us a little bit about that.
Well, that advice depends on what time period. If you put money in Iran's banks 5-6 years ago, you would do a lot better in dollar terms today, because the interest rates were 20 to 25%, and then the exchange rate didn't keep up. Dollar did not become expensive enough to take care of that. So you would have made a lot of money. That's why there was money going into Iran. People were taking their money in Iran, turning it into rial, putting it in the banks, getting these huge deposit rates of 20, 25%, especially when inflation is 10%. You know, you're making like 10% in real terms. That is not sustainable in any economy for any period of time. Real interest rates are about 2 to 3%, meaning the gap between inflation rate and the interest rate cannot be more than 2 or 3%. Otherwise, there's no level of productivity for investment. of investment that would allow people to go borrow and be able to make profits and then pay on top of that 10% in real terms back to the lender. Now, the exchange rate in Iran is a barometer of what is going on. Luckily, I think for Iran, they haven't gone the route of completely stopping the parallel market, which is to silence the voice that comes through the transaction of dollar and real. There's a very active market. Part of that market is active because people are taking money out of Iran. So dollar is susceptible not just to economic conditions like productivity differences, price level differences between Iran and the rest of the world. It's also susceptible to psychology. If you get urban protests that we've been talking about, you become uncertain about the country. Maybe you think you need to leave, send money. There are literally hundreds of thousands of Iranians who live in Iran, have relatives, maybe their wives and children, in US, Canada, and Australia. They're sending money all the time. And you know, if you go to western eastern coast of Spain, you see a lot of Iranians who own homes. All that money wasn't earned in Spain. It was transferred from Iran outside. I think last year there was an estimate of $6 billion that left Iran through this. So there is no surprise for me to see the dollar go up. And I was actually disappointed that the government reacted the way it did. You know, from an economic point of view, if you have 50% inflation rate between 2012 and 2017, right? Your wages are going up by 50% for a producer. If the dollar doesn't go up by the same amount, that means when you want to export stuff, you're not getting enough reals back to pay your workers. That's a huge problem for producers. There's a lobby in Iran constantly arguing the dollar has to become more expensive. Now, the middle class, the bureaucratic class, maybe the poor, they're all into this thing, we need cheaper dollar. Because we can travel abroad, we can send money to our kids, we can buy real estate in Spain. If the dollar had kept up with the differential of inflation between Iran and the rest of the world, it would have been another 30% higher today. So for people to be as competitive in selling stuff in Turkmenistan, this is Iranian producers, they would want a dollar that is at least 30% higher. It reached for a day to, if you're familiar with Iran currency, to 5,000 tumans per dollar. It came back down to 4,500. And in 5 years ago, the exchange rate was 3,500. So you would have expected the dollar to appreciate, the real to depreciate every year, nearly every year, by the gap between inflation abroad and inflation in Iran, and it didn't. So you have suppressed exchange rate, right? You have bought low inflation. You remember inflation I talked about? It was partly bought with low dollar rates, with the low exchange rate. So it's a good thing. You keep the dollar low, import prices stay the same. You say, wonderful, we have low inflation. But then that's, reality is going to catch up with you, which has now. So inflation in Iran is going to spike as a result of the devaluation. But I don't think, again, it's something that is terribly important, like it's going to disrupt the whole economy. As I said, there's a good part of it, that the dollar is more expensive because now there's more companies that can sell things abroad. And there's a bad side of it, that the middle class can travel easily to Turkey for this year's New Year.
Yeah, I just wanted to add something to what you said about the depreciation of Iranian currency, that it has also reactivated the borders. I mean, because of the depreciation of Iranian currency, we had these back and forth movements became even more important for transborder populations. And because, you know, at the time of even Ahmadinejad, Dubai imported more smuggled oil from Iran than they bought from Abu Dhabi, the neighboring Emirates. Because Iranian oil was so cheap and they could smuggle it through, with the involvement of emerging oligarchies that we now see in Iran. So just saying that the impact of it on the borders.
Yes, smugglers are exporters.
That's incredible.
Yes, so exactly. Real ones.
they like it.
So I detected a kind of an interesting thread in your observations and Javad's observations, and that is that Iran is struggling to infuse some, what's the word I jotted down here, some certainty into a lot of uncertain areas, including its economy, including how it wants its relations with Israel to be or not to be, that is what the big question. But having said that, if I may quickly just turn to Nura, because you also touched on some of the inconsistencies, the vagueness of the constitutional debate in Iran. So I'd like you to please expand on that. And from the economic front, we know as Kurdistan's borders shut down, Iran's exports to Kurdistan were higher than its entire exports to Central Asia at large. So if you can also talk a little bit about that, but that will be two questions. We're going to take one more question and make it three, please.
Actually, I have two questions, but they both relate to the nuclear agreement.
Okay.
One is, what is Iran's reaction likely to be if the U.S. pulls out? And the second is, how likely is it that if the arrangement or agreement remains in place, that Iran will evolve into a peaceful participant in the international community as President Obama hoped?
Thank you very much. So I'll turn the floor to Nura and to Amin very briefly, then we'll move to the heated discussion over Iran's nuclear program. Nura to go first, please.
So the question was just about
the uncertainty and the vagueness of the constitutional debate. Where do you see that going? How is it going to affect Iran?
Yeah, well, what's interesting is that, sort of to echo what Dr. Salehi-Isfahani said, just after the recent protests, I think a common refrain in the media was as we often see when there are protests in Iran, a common refrain was, well, is this finally it? Is this when another revolution is going to happen? Behind that refrain is always this, one almost perceives like a hope that it will be the end, and that an entirely new regime will be founded from scratch, another revolution will happen. But I think what these ambiguities in the Constitution reveal, and kind of the ambiguities in Khomeini's thought and contemporary debates in Iran reveal, is that there are ideas with which to work. There are democratic ideas circulating. There are democratic principles that reformists embrace, and that they have hope that these principles will one day, form the basis of concrete institutional change and political change in Iran. So it's not necessary to sort of scrap the whole thing because we know that it's not necessary to scrap the whole thing because there are resources available ideologically and also in terms of the way we look at the way institutions function to reform the system in a way such that it becomes more just and fair and a little bit more democratic.
That's very interesting. Does this resonate with your observations on the borders, that they're just making do with what exists and hoping that something better will emerge?
Well, for Iraq, the situation is quite different because it's the first destination of Iranian products. So it's a huge market. And the role of Kurdistan is very important because not only Kurdistan itself is a market for Iran, but also it's a corridor for the Iraqi market. So Iranian market products, they go through Iraqi Kurdistan. And it has an impact at different levels, as I said, at the border level, but also many Iranian businessmen who are involved in this situation. If we look at it from a broader perspective, I believe that the 15 years, or more or less, of sanctions helped Iran to be integrated regionally, but from below. Of course, there is no, or ties are not very well built between neighboring countries, But this, you know, the 15 years of sanctions helped Iran to develop networks by default. And finally, Iranians, they started looking at their own regions. The role of Armenia, the role of Georgia, the role of Iraq and Iraqi Kurdistan were paramount in these situations. So these networks exist today, and the lifting of sanctions, because these are human infrastructures that were built organically, they are not going to destroy and there might be some resistance, as you mentioned, to even, you know, the lifting of sanctions from groups and people who benefited from the sanctions during this time.
And this, you know, this is lovely because it ties very neatly into the JCPOA debate. So with this in mind, what does the JCPOA entail for Iran? What does pulling out of it by the United States entail? Or for that matter, will the United States look at these realities on the ground that surround Iran internally and regionally and say, well, I may just remain for a bit longer, and how will that lead to peace? Does anyone want to take the challenge of this question? Please.
Yeah, it's a very good question, and it's very much in the air because of the assault by the Trump administration on the nuclear deal. There is quite a bit of asymmetry between Iran and the U.S. vis-a-vis this deal. For the U.S., putting pressure on it is all gain. The costs are not easily seen. What happens if Iran collapses in some sense? You know, what happens if Iran goes back to nuclear enrichment? But the fact that this is creating political pressure on Iran by just scaring away foreign investment sounds good. So they are interested in doing it. For Iran, it's really difficult to choose between JCPOA and the alternative. The reason is that economic conditions, as the Supreme Leader has said, people in the streets have said, Rouhani himself has said, is the main issue in the country. Now, JCPOA is helping the economy. It has the potential to lower unemployment, to raise real incomes in Iran. The alternative, which is to go back to enrichment, doesn't seem to have that kind of a relationship with the economy. So what do you do if you pull out of JCPOA? You know, JCPOA is now working maybe 50%, maybe 30%. I don't know the exact number. But 30% JCPOA is still better for the economy, if that is your concern, than nuclear enrichment, because it doesn't employ people and it's not something you're exporting, you're earning money. So Iran's kind of in a bind. It likes to stay in it, and it probably will. It will not quit, because even a 10% JCPOA is better than having UN reimpose sanctions, because once the UN reimposes sanctions, even South Korea, that's investing $10 billion in Iran, even China, won't be able to do it, no matter how much they disagree with the Trump administration. So I think that what the game, and I think also the US is not going to pull out, because why pull out if you can threaten and get your, if you can scare away investors and achieve partially your goals? Why bring the bad name of United States having exited the deal? So it's basically going to be a patient that's kind of dying, and nobody's going to admit it until it's actually dead.
Well, hopefully we'll know, but nobody will die in the process. Did you want to take on?
I mean, I would like to add a couple of things to what Nura and Djavad said. One thing is related to this context of the Constitution. I remember when 2009 protests took place, that everybody talked about the delegitimization of the Islamic Republic and the lack of meaning for provided to elections once the elections proved to be fraudulent in the re-election of Ahmadinejad. A lot of people that I talked to in Iran in 2009, that they promised me I will never vote again, then they voted in 2013. And what we saw, I mean, in the slide I showed, is that how these people that they were disenchanted or frustrated with what happened in 2009, they decided to give a chance to the electoral process in order to give the chance to someone who was proposing something different. In this case was Rouhani, before it was Ahmadinejad, and before it was Khatami. So every time that we have presidential elections in Iran, there is a chance for people to give some opinion about who we don't want to rule the country or who we want to rule the country. In this case, it was Rouhani, and Rouhani's main achievement during his first term was the JCPOA. The other elections, legislative and the re-election of Rouhani, proved that the people, the Iranian people, even though they don't see that many results of this JCPOA at economic or domestic level, they still support the deal because they still consider that this was the main achievement. And the fact that Iran was reinstated in the international community, whether other states like it or not, but it became a trustable partner in other in regional or international trade or international agreements. So this is something that should be recognized, that Iran became much more important at regional international level because of the JCPOA. So as I agree with Djavad, I don't see room for Iran to abandon the deal because they don't have any benefit in abandoning that. So they will continue.
They will continue. Thank you. Please.
Hi, thank you for the talk. Within the next decade, we're going to see a new supreme leader in Iran. And so Dr. Hossainzadeh touched upon the constitutional reforms that took place in 1989 when we had the succession of after Khomeini. And I wonder if you can talk a little bit about if you see this change that's going to happen in the next 10, at some point in the next 10 years, it being another opportunity for constitutional reform, and if so, what kind of reform? And also, if local politics have any role to play, I know maybe not officially, but unofficially, in that process, and if popular opinion has any role to play in that process. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for the question. So it's a good question. Recently, as you know, there were elections for the Assembly of Experts, and moderates and reformist-leaning supporters of Rouhani in general won a greater proportion of the seats, so they gained in the number of seats in the Assembly of Experts. So this is hopeful. This is perhaps a hopeful sign that this assembly, which may be the one that will choose the next supreme leader, might make a slightly different choice. Might choose a supreme leader who has less conservative leanings as the current than the current supreme leader. So that definitely will be an important development to watch. And there, I think that there is potential for the new supreme leader to be somebody who ideologically is very much different than the current one. And as far as a local politics, that's a good question. I mean, I'm wondering if any of my fellow panelists could speak to that. I know less about that.
The local aspect.
Yeah, the local politics. Aspect.
If I may add, I mean, of course, there is a lot of debate about the future of the Islamic Republic, the future shape, if it's going to be a constitutional reform, who may be the next leader. The problem is these debates are not public and they are not visible for outsiders. In Qom, there are a lot of seminars that they are discussing whether if there is a reform in the constitution, the institution of Belayat de Faqih should change to something more supervisory rather than executive. You know that not everybody in the clerical establishment share the same ideas of having this idea of Velayat de Faqih. Actually, Al-Sistani, which is one of the most important Marja Taqlid, which is residing in Iraq, has a different opinion. And Al-Sistani has a lot of supporters in Qom. So there is an open debate about what should be done. The problem is this is at a theoretical level, at the religious level, but hasn't transcended to a political level. But there are some people that they are already asking for, for legalization of political parties, for a referendum in order to decide whether Iran would become parliamentary system or not. So there are a lot of open debates. What would happen in the future? I mean, it's almost impossible to predict because Iran is very unpredictable in that sense. But of course, at the domestic level, there are all these debates, sometimes in the press, sometimes in religious circles, sometimes in political or university circles.
Thank you, please.
Hello, thank you for your presentations. It's very good to hear about Iran in these days. I'm especially encouraged to hear about the developing networks and the development of democracy inside Iran. One thing I'd like to ask you to address is the, I have a concern about the interaction between China and Iran. The more that we have imposed U.S. sanctions, the less trading there's been with Europe and U.S., and the increase in trading with China. Right now, China is Iran's greatest trading partner, and that's one area I'd like you to address. The second one is that the Chinese government has recently extended huge loans of credit to Iran, most recently a $10 billion line of credit. And is this building a credit debt that Iran may be unable to repay, which would result in political, I shouldn't use the word blackmailing, but could it be political coercion to increase the distance between Iran and the U.S.?
Thank you. Is there another question? I'd like to take that, please.
Quickly on the disparity between the military expenditures in Israel and Iran, 3.5 times or whatever it is. I point out the population of Iran is 10 times the population of Israel, so on an aggregate basis, it's much higher. But this is probably a geographic question, but half of Iran are minorities, ethnic minorities. What role does that play in everything you've been talking about?
Okay, so we have two interesting questions, one on the economy and Iran's economic policies with China, and the second one about ethnic issues in Iran, which I will invite the panel to respond to. Would you like to start with the economic question?
China.
Yeah, it's a very good question. You know, Iran has, for the last 200 years, been the scene of great power politics, so it's not surprising that this continues. And now there are three big players in some sense, the West, or mostly the US, and China and Russia. And they've kind of divided labor among themselves. Chinese do economy, Russians do military, and the West is kind of watching Iran. The one thing that is very important to recognize is that the flow of goods and flow of investment has a cultural dimension. In other words, Iranian middle class, Iranian businessmen much rather travel to Frankfurt for a business deal than to go to China because they have relatives in Germany, right? So there is an inequality between the Chinese and the West, and the Chinese know that it's much harder for them to come to Iran. They have to bring money, they have to bring expertise. That makes them very effective people in some sense because there's nothing else Iranians are going to get out of them. It's not like, can you help my son get into a Chinese university? You know, like that is a very important part for the Iranian middle class. So I think that the Chinese trade, which is now diminishing, by the way, you know, China had Iran almost as a hostage because Iran had no other opportunities. Chinese were the powerful country that could bend the sanctions. They were giving Iran a lot of their goods that ordinarily would sell in dollar stores here. Iranians were very upset with that trade arrangements, and they've always found the Europeans have better culture in investment and trading. That may sound counterintuitive, but the Chinese are new in foreign investment. And it's not like the Chinese government. It's like some Chinese guy will come and say, I want to do this in your town, and they may not deliver, or they may not stay. They say, I'll export you the raw materials you want. The quality may be low. This doesn't happen if you import from Germany. Things are much smoother. So I don't think Iran is easily going to go give up its connections with Europe and with the West in favor of China. What was the other question I had?
About ethnic issues, if anyone
I just want to say one quick thing about the ethnic things. The best we can determine, the minorities are about, unless you consider Azerbaijanis, Turkic-speaking Iranians, as minorities. They don't consider themselves a minority at all. If you think of minorities as the Kurds and the Sunnis, they're about 10% of the population. So it's not true that half of Iran, maybe in some geographic sense, you can say half of Iran, but half of the population doesn't feel like a minority at all. It's like more like 10%.
Thank you. I mean, would you like right. to add something to this?
Well, on minorities, I should say, you know, when you are from a minority, your anthropologist would say that your identity is very fluid. So you can play with these various borders and feeling of belongings that you have. I think we can apply that to, you know, minority groups as well in Iran, in a sense that there is always a bargain between Iranian state and minorities. In a way, Iranian state needs also minorities because of this transborder, again, relations that Iran needs to have. And, you know, they were also, in some situations, they also reactivated their networks to help Iranian state bodies to circumvent the sanctions, for instance. Not that they were really helping the Iranian state directly. They had their own goals because they had to work, but they worked with each other. Now, again, it depends on the policies that Iran, integrative policies that Iran puts in place or not in different political periods, I think. So I think it's not always against or for the system.
That's very interesting. If you don't want to add here, I'll take the... And just say that I'm happy to squeeze in time for just one extra question, and then unfortunately we have to wrap up the meeting. Yes, sure.
I just wondered what the relationship is between Iran's funding of resistance groups in different countries around it and how it affects Iran's well-being in general.
Thank you, and we'll take the last question, please.
That's perfect, actually, because my question is almost the same. It was mentioned before regarding Iran's foreign policy that one of the panelists felt it was very unlikely there would be war between Israel and Iran, but things have been really heating up in Syria, where Israel sees the Iranian-backed Shia militias throughout the region, as well as Iranian presence itself, as one and the same as Iranian presence. And in U.S. foreign policy circles in the last few months, there's been this very nebulous idea of countering Iranian presence in the region. So my first question is, what does this Iranian presence mean in terms of Iranian economy, and how is that a drain on the economy or not? There's activity in Iraq, there's activity in Yemen as well. And how is this perceived by the Iranian people? When Iranian people hear about Iranian foreign policy and presence throughout the region, how do the Iranian people feel about this, and is it a point of tension at all?
Thank you. So basically two important questions. How much does it cost Iran to support resistance groups? And secondly, how much of a drain is Syria for Iran's economy? And to what extent do people in Iran really empathize with the Syrian quagmire? The panel is open for this.
I can say just something very maybe basic that first of all, we don't know how much Iran spends to support its Syria project. It spends very little money in Yemen. So Iran uses these the groups it supports very efficiently in some sense in terms of money. And as someone mentioned, Iran has a relatively low defense budget. So even if you add that money to Iran's defense budget, it's still not nearly as high as Saudi Arabia, for example. So I would say that it isn't putting an inordinate pressure on domestic resources. But sure, every dollar you spend abroad, it's like spending it even on police for the neighborhoods, you know, is money that comes out of something else. So it is costly. We don't know exactly how much, but because Iran doesn't have such a large defense budget, as a proportion of GDP, I would say is still not up there in some sense, mm-hmm. relative to
Thank
its
you.
Neighbors.
What about the Syria issue?
I mean, within the Iranian population, I think there are two different narratives. One saying that, I mean, people that is convinced that it's necessary to fight in Iran and Syria and in the whole region, because this is the way to defend the Iranian borders. And this has been very explicitly shared by a lot of people, official and non-officials. Fighting Daesh in Syria and fighting Daesh in Iraq represents a defense of the Iranian borders, because if we don't fight them there, we will need to fight them in our own borders. So this is a very extended narrative that supports the Iranian involvement in both scenarios in order to fight against Daesh, ISIS. The other, which is what Djavad said, nobody really knows how much money is spent on that, but in the protests and even in some surveys conducted along the 2017, it showed that shows that there are people, the criticism started to be raised among people that they don't see a result of the JCPOA in their own lives, while they consider that they are spending too much money in these scenarios. But as we said, I mean, we don't know how much money. So we are discussing about ideological issues rather than evidence or facts. So that said, I mean, it's very difficult to see whether the Iranian involvement or within other regional scenarios or with other resistance groups will affect the Iranian economy or not. Moreover, having in mind that Iran has been always supporting some groups like Hezbollah in the 80s, and they were always under sanctions. I mean, Iran is always since 1979, has been under sanctions, and since 2006 by the United Nations and European Union. However, the economy is still moving. So I don't see that much harm on the Iranian economy despite of the Iranian involvement abroad.
So it looks like we're looking at both divisive and cohesive phenomenon when we look at Iran and put it into perspective. The protests, the unrest, the economic challenges are valid, but we are also looking at an Iran that is resilient. It is evolving. The narratives that have evolved since the revolution, within the revolution, and precisely as a result of the revolution, are quite interesting. I hope this offers just one way of looking at Iran, mindful that there are multiple dimensions to Iran's reality. Before ending the discussion today, I just want to first and foremost thank our panelists and our hosts and all of you who spend your valuable time being with us today. And I also want to make an announcement that here at Princeton on March 1st at noon, we will have a Professor Lawrence Luer, who will arrive to speak about Shias in the Gulf monarchies. The event will be held at 300 Wallace Hall, and there is information as you leave the door about it. So thank you all, and thank you very much.
Thank you.